Hello, welcome to this Virtual Pair Programmers module, where we will be looking at how to deploy your Java applications to a live running server. I've produced this course in response to a question which we're frequently asked at Virtual Pair Programmers. After you've developed a web application locally, using an IDE and a local server like Tomcat, how can you get that application running on a live internet-based server? And the other reason that we've produced this video is that, as you may know, it's very common now for developers to be also expected to take at least some responsibility towards also operating the production environment. And this is a trend known as DevOps. So if you're a DevOp, you might be responsible for developing, deploying, and monitoring the live system. This is going to be a short course. It's about 3 hours, because honestly, I don't know how popular this is going to be with you, the subscribers. So the idea is that this module is just to get you started. By the end of this module, you will have a website up and running. It will be publicly available on the internet, and it will be connected to a live MySQL database. If we get good viewing figures, then in the future, I will expand the DevOps series. We'll go deeper. So in those future modules, we might automate the deployment, we might use elastic load balancing, and well, really, the topics are endless. It's a huge area to explore. But that's only going to happen if there's interest in this module. If nobody watches, then we will quietly forget all about it. So thanks for listening this far. This is the first course that we've done where we won't really be doing any programming. In the zip folder for this course, you'll find a starting workspace which contains a typical Java web development. You can, of course, open the project that I've supplied in any IDE. As usual for our courses, I'm going to use Eclipse for the videos. The process for opening Eclipse is the usual process on our courses. You need to unzip the starting workspace into a folder. That's going to be your workspace that you're going to launch. Close this welcome tab, it's not very useful, and go to File, New, Java Project, and type very carefully MVC Project. And you must spell that exactly the same as here, including case sensitivity. And you should see a message saying the wizard will automatically configure the JRE. You can now click Finish, and we're good to go. So feel free to explore the contents of this project. As I say, it's a very simple Spring MVC project. You will recognize it if you've done previous courses with us. At present, the Spring config file that we're picking up is this one here, application.xml. Really simple this. The two service classes, the important one is the book service here, is an in-memory mock implementation. In the second part of this course, we're going to switch that for a production one. You can build the WAR file by right-clicking on build.xml and run as ant build. That will build the WAR file in the dist directory. It's called bookstore.war. You can now deploy this to a local Tomcat instance. You might have your own techniques for doing this. I'm doing this by running the starttomcat.bat file in the workspace. If you're on Mac or Linux, then you can navigate into the Tomcat directory, then into the bin directory, and you're looking for the startup.sh shell script. When you've got that deployed, you should be able to visit the URL localhost8080/bookstore/view/books.do. And we have here a long, hard-coded list of book titles. The object of this course, then, is to get this same WAR file deployed to a live running server. So broadly speaking, there are three main ways that I can think of doing that. You could set up your own server for yourself, and I mean, really, buy your own hardware, which you will set up in your own premises. We could somehow then connect that to a fast internet line, And that's traditionally how very big projects would be run. Effectively, your company would be running its own data center. The other approach you might be aware of is you could set up a virtual private server, or VPS. There are many companies out there offering virtual private servers. I'm not recommending any particular provider here. I'm showing you one example. This is a company called RhymeU Hosting. I've chosen these because we have experience of working with RhymeU Hosting. They were the hosts of Virtual Pair Programmers on the day we launched the company many years ago now. And we used them for quite a few years. The idea behind a virtual private server is you go to a company like RhymeU Hosting. We would sign up for a hosting plan. And what you're really doing here is you're renting a server in a data center. Well, you're not really renting an entire server. What they've done is they've taken servers running virtualization software, so a single physical server has been divided up into multiple virtual servers. But that doesn't matter. The end result as a DevOps is that I feel like I have my own private server with full root access. This is still a viable option today, but there are a few problems with virtual private servers, and I would summarize that as they're not particularly flexible and they can be quite expensive. I hope RhymeU Hosting will forgive me for doing this. Actually, RhymeU Hosting are a very competitive company, but at the time of this recording, even for their lowest priced server, this is their budget server, you're going to be looking at an outlay of $25 per month. That might not sound a lot, and it might not be a lot for you, but the problem is it's $25 regardless of how much you use that server. So even if you set it up and we use it for an hour and that's all we need, well, you've got a $25 charge for the month's use. The other problem is that this isn't a particularly powerful virtual private server. Notice there's only 4 GB of disk. And you can see at a glance from the pricing scheme that if you wanted 12 GB of disk, then you can see that the costs are going up quite steeply. So don't get me wrong, I'm certainly not criticizing RhymeU Hosting. They're a great company with competitive plans. The other problem with virtual private servers is that it can be difficult to work with Java on a VPS. Well, actually, that's the reason why we chose RhymeU Hosting, because they are very good at working with Java. Their servers are well optimized for Java. But in some of the other VPS companies, you get a very basic installation and you would have to work very hard to get Java running. So a VPS is still a good option for some purposes, but depending on what you're trying to do, it can be an expensive and inflexible option. But of course, this course is centered around Amazon Web Services. Now, in many ways, Amazon Web Services, or AWS, is the same as a VPS. We can rent a server from AWS, and we will be able to do anything that we want with that server. But the big difference is that Amazon Web Services are only going to be billing us for the resources that we use, and their billing model is flexible. So it's possible with AWS to deploy a tiny server where you're using small amounts of disk space, and your charges will be minimal. On this course, if you do everything that I do on the video, you're going to get all or most of these resources for free. However, once your website starts to expand and you start to use more and more resources, you can scale up the deployment really easily. That's why you're going to see the term elastic used in a lot of AWS. That's really their marketing term to suggest that we can very easily stretch and scale your resources according to demand. And a lot of that we can do automatically. At Virtual Pair Programmers, we moved to AWS around the year 2010. And the great thing about AWS has been that as we've got bigger and we've added more and more courses, our costs have gone up, but the costs have gone up in a very linear fashion. I can tell you it would have been impossible to store the course material that we have today, which is terabytes. It would have been very expensive, or maybe even impossible, to store that on a virtual private server. But on AWS, we don't think about it. As we add more resources, the bills just go up a little bit. AWS is just one of a number of so-called cloud-based hosting platforms. There are many competitors to AWS. I would say the biggest competitor is Microsoft Azure, but there are others. One example would be OpenShift from Red Hat, which, as they explain here, this is their application hosting platform, which makes it easy to run your web applications in the cloud for free. So it's a competitive area, but at the time of this recording, AWS is easily the leader in the field. The reason that I've chosen to use AWS for the course is really that I have more experience of using it than the other platforms, because we use it in anger at virtual pair programmers. I think the other reason is that AWS is also very feature-rich, and at the time of this recording, they're leading the way in the number of features that they provide as part of the package. So we're not here to sell AWS, they're just a good example cloud platform that we can use for this course. The first job we need to do on the course is you need to get yourself an account at Amazon Web Services, if you haven't already got one. The problem with doing this, of course, is they're going to change the layout of this sign-on page over time, but I'm hoping that the steps you need to follow should be fairly straightforward. You should be able to work them out for yourself. So we'll start by clicking Sign into the console. Straightforward login box here, but the slight complexity is this is integrated with the regular Amazon Web Store, their identity management. So that means if you have an account with Amazon at amazon.com or .co.uk or .de, then you can use your username and password here, the same credentials that you use on the Amazon store. If, however, you're a brand new customer, and I'm going to simulate a new customer here, I'm using a fake email address. If you're a new user, you can click the I am a new user button here, and you don't need to supply a password just yet. You'll need to type in your name on this form here and then confirm your email address, and then choose yourself a good strong password, which you will need to confirm. As I say, you won't need to do this account if you already have an account on any of the international Amazon store sites. You're then presented with a form. This should be easy to fill in. I won't bother doing that on camera. Now for the important step, you will have to provide payment information. My plan for this course is, where possible, we're going to use free resources, which you get for AWS as a trial for 1 year as a new customer. That's called the free tier. Even if you're on the free tier, you do still need to supply a credit or debit card, and that's so they can bill you if you go over the free usage. Now, I'm going to work hard to try to avoid going over the free usage tier, but it is possible that you might incur some charges. And certainly on future modules, we might use some services that are not part of the free tier. So, of course, I'll do the credit and debit card off camera. They take security seriously at AWS, so the next step is identity verification. You are going to need to provide a genuine telephone number here, and you will get an automated call as a result of pressing the button here. The call is fully automated, however, you won't need to talk to anybody. Off camera, I got my call from Amazon Web Services, and I confirmed the PIN number that was supplied. And then on the next page, I'm invited to sign up for a support plan, which we don't need, so you can select the free option and continue. And you should now be able to sign into the console. So log in as usual. And what you should see once you've logged into the console is you should have a list of available Amazon Web Services. Now, I wanted to step through that process because if you have any problems with your billing, then you won't be seeing this front screen. Amazon will have taken a trial payment from your debit or credit card, and they do that just to make sure that your credit card is live. They will refund the payment immediately. But until you've done that, you won't be able to do anything on the AWS console. So if you have any problems doing any of the tasks that we're about to do, then it may well just be that you've got a problem with the payment card and you might need to perhaps enter a new one. Well, before we start doing any work on AWS, I'll give you a quick introduction to some of the services that you can use. The list of services available here is really quite bewildering, and it really does feel like every time I log in, there's something new here. I don't have time to go through all of the services, but I will show you the big ones. By far, the most important service supplied by AWS is this one here called EC2. It stands for Elastic Cloud Compute, which is a silly name, really, in my opinion. This is the service that allows us to spin up virtual computers with ease. So it's effectively a direct replacement for VPS. This will be the key focus of this course. But there are some others that are worth pointing out. There's one here called Elastic Beanstalk. I am planning a future module on Beanstalk. This gives a pre-configured server, which has already got your web server, like Tomcat, and all of the additional services that you need for a website, all pre-built. And the best thing about it is it's pre-configured to grow and shrink depending on how much usage that server is getting. So it's a great service, that, but I think it is just a little bit too complicated to start with, so we might return to that later. S3 is a really important service. This is the simple storage service. This allows you to store and retrieve files, and the files can be any size you like. You only pay for the storage that you're using. As a good example, all of Virtual Pair Programmers courses are stored on S3. So almost certainly, the video you're watching now is being served from an Amazon S3 instance. A little further down, and we will be using this on the course, is RDS, which is the Relational Database Service. And with just a few clicks of the mouse, we can spin up a full database instance pre-configured with not too much work. And you'll even get things like automatic backups for free. Well, I mean free as in very little effort. There will be charges. Some of the services are quite small. This one here, the simple email service, is for sending emails. Not particularly exciting, perhaps, but critical to many applications. There are some more just off camera here. You might be familiar already with EMR, Elastic MapReduce, which Matt Greencroft covered in detail on our Hadoop training course. So you might want to check that out if you're interested. Some of them are very specialized. This one here, for example, the Elastic Transcoder, is used if you want to very quickly convert videos from one format to another. We use that at Virtual Pair Programmers to produce our videos behind the scenes. So for this course, we'll be focusing on EC2 to run a server and RDS to manage a database.